going to revise it? If I'm going to revise, what implant I'm going to use? Am I going to use a bone graft? And what is the method I may have to employ on removing the previous implant? Sometimes you may require even metal cutters and instruments to remove the cement as well. Now, there are various reasons why the knee failed, and we've had good papers on that. The commonest reason is the infection, what we've dealt with in a separate session completely. Only the tibia has failed, and once you open, you may feel that the femur is quite well fixed and you only need to revise the tibia. So you need to know whether I need a long stay. In Bombay, Tata Hospital has got a good bone bank, and we can get good bone from there now. It's bold. Read the old notes. There are certain things that are not mentioned in the notes. You know, they can be, you ask the oral implant is put in slight flexion and the tibia has an excessive posterior slope. In such patients, this particular area of the post is hitting into the metal of the box, and sometimes the wear will be there, that debris will give you pain. At the same time, this will eventually break and make the knee very unstable, and you may have to go for a consent implant over there. As you saw a case of metallosis, you can on the x-ray see that the poly is completely gone and both the metals are touching. Although the patient may not be in severe pain, but there is a reactionary effusion and severe swelling. So in such a case, you're better off devising it early, because quite often, I mean, Dr. Dholake used to say that whenever a patient has undergone a primary, he has signed a contract with the surgeon. So when the surgeon says you should revise now, patient should not wait. Because if they wait for long, the surgery may become more difficult and you may require the bigger implants for that. Now, a case like this, where there is a supracondylar fracture and this is the non-union, such a case is going to be difficult to fix or use any other implant, but you need a resection implant like a GMRS implant to salvage this particular patient. You can see that resection implant has been put and then the patient is able to walk immediately. In this particular patient, the patient had a unicondylar knee and there was an intraocular fracture. Now, I spoke to the surgeon. You know, this is done with navigation, so there are pins over here. So if you want to do anything to the patient, you need to bypass this area as well. And it's a unique knee done with a burr. These are inlay implants. Onlay implants are very easy to remove, but in the inlay implants, there is no border. You cannot get any border between the bone and the implant, and sometimes they are more difficult to remove. So he told me that I've done it with a burr, and it's completely flush with the articular cartilage, and you know, so perhaps then he went ahead and fixed it first. So it's important to find out whether there was the best sensorimus tendon or medial collateral ligament, any damage has been done to that or no. Eventually this patient required a consent implant, it was fixed. So it's important to speak to the surgeon what he has done before. The collateral ligament. CT scans are important. You may be having a fracture just under the implant which is not picked up by the x-ray. Mars MRI, as we discussed, can show you metal debris, can show you polymer, can also show you the lucent lines, can also tell you about the infection. PET scan can add to your information. This is, you can see the collateral laxity on both sides, and also there is so much of recurvatum. So although it's a TS implant, it still has a laxity, so you need to go for a hinged implant in this. Persistent dislocation, case like infection where you've got lucent lines around, so x-rays can help you that. The presence of osteolysis on the tibia is very important, because most revision surgery, the patella tendon is quite contracted and it's very difficult to evert the patella. So if you see an osteolysis at the tibial tubercle and you don't notice that, you may develop a fracture because of scar tissue. Quadriceps tendon also can be thickened. The preserving patella tendon integrity is one of the most important things in soft tissue, because you can tackle the collaterals or other instability by using a constrained implant or a hinged implant. But if you develop a extensive mechanism disruption, then you are not able to salvage this particular knee. Sometimes patella may have to be tackled with tibial tubercle osteotomy or quad slip or a VY plastic. If there are multiple incisions, you must take the lateral most incision. If you happen to take a medial incision, you have to keep a gap of 6 to 8 cm between the two incisions. Don't elevate any flap on the lateral side, and if you elevate flap medially, it should be on a subfacial plane. As you can see, you can, in elevating the patella, detach the quadriceps tendon from the femur over here, clean both the medial and lateral gutters with all the syelovitis and syelovium should be removed. Sometimes doing inside out lateral retinal loop, so that you can dislocate the patella laterally without actually having to evert it. then you can release medially and dislocate the tibia forward. If you are finding that the flexion is less than 70 or there is an osteolysis, you may have to do quad snip. The quad snip has to be done 6 cm above the patella with an incision from distal medial to proximal lateral at a 45 degree angle. In some tight knees, you may have to extend it into the vastus lateralis as well. That is how it needs to be done. You can take this particular snip into the quadriceps tendon and even go laterally if required. This probably is the safest of the three methods. UIplasty, quad snip and TTO. This is the safest of the three methods. UIplasty, we used to do a lot of them before, but now I would reserve it only for a long-term bony ankylosed knee. If they are not bending at all, then you may have to go for a UIplasty. As you can see here, after the surgery, the V has been converted into Y and the knee has been closed. A lot of these patients develop quadriceps line and they need to be protected in long knee brace for a long time. TTO is quite handy. If quad snip is not going to work, then TTO is a better option. We require a good bone, this is fine. You need to make sure that you end the TTO over here. Don't go into the joint line. It has to be long. A small or a short TTO is a big problem, minimum 6 cm long. Fix it with wires over here. You can see that how the TTO has been outlined into this bone model. And then you evert it laterally and fix it with wire. Thank you very much.
The previous one. And most of them have been already covered as well. So during the revision, the main point is that we need to have adequate incision, adequate exposure, so that we are not working in a constrained environment which further can cause more damage to the bone. These are the tools we need to have. Osteotomes, varieties, if you have flexible one will be great. Giggly saw, a power saw. Ultrasonic device, if you can have something called as a which we used to use earlier, especially in the hips, called Oscars, burrs if needed to remove the cement or if you have to cut the metal. So the strategies are like good exposure. If you have loose implants, even then you have to take care of carefully. Otherwise, along with the loose implant, you can pull off the bone. It will be more difficult with well-fixed implants, especially with an uncemented one. What should be the order of removal in the tibial, in the knee revisions? The first is the tibial poly, because if you remove the tibial poly, you have good space to work around. Then the next is the tibial tray, if you especially can dislocate the knee nicely. Then the femoral component, and lastly, if there is a patella, this is replaced. So this is one of the index case. Using this, we will go through each step. So nicely draped, and we prepare even for the implant removal like a proper knee replacement, because it's going to be a very important surgery with all aseptic precautions. Exposure has been done and you can see the pus coming out there, so it's an infected first stage revision. So the first thing is a nice exposure. Usually in these cases we don't have to do either quadriceps snip or tibial osteotomies. In fact, they have been discussed so much in the meetings, and most of the times we see them in the next meeting only. We don't use them so much. You have to be very careful in taking them home as a routine approaches. So once they have nicely been exposed and the tibia is subluxated, then you can use a normal osteotomes to remove the tibial poly. Make sure that the posterior lateral corner of the tibia is nicely subluxed forward, otherwise it will not come out. So then delineate the tibial plateau under the tibial component nicely so that you can make out the junction properly. Once you know that, use your smallest saw blade possible on your in the hospital and use them between the cement and the metal so that you will not further damage the bone underneath. And make sure that the direction of the saw is more towards the tibial plate rather than towards the cement. You can also use this technique, which is called stacking of these osteotomes. You can use a broad osteotome underneath, as you see on the right side picture, and use a smaller osteotome on top of it. Because of the broad surface of the two osteotomes, see the underlying osteotome, you will not damage the underlying bone. Once you have done that, you have released the cement underneath either with osteotomes or with the small saw, you should try to hammer that tibial plate out. The problem here is that either you should use the designated, the implant removal or the insertion handle, otherwise you try to hammer it out from the front using your osteotome or a blunt any instrument or a punch, you will be extracting that implant in an angle, not in a straight line, which will actually pull out more bone either from the posterior side or from the lateral side, which is very difficult to release sometimes. So it's important that, you know, use an instrument, something like a hook, or use the proper handle, and you pull the posterior part first rather than the anterior part, because the anterior part, you know that you have nicely released it. Once the compress is out, you can see the cement, you have not damaged the bone. In fact, you know, you have cut at least 50% of the places between the cement and the component. Then use the same saw, take a small layer of cement, including maybe a little bone, to get a nice smooth bone like the second picture. Then play your attention towards the femur. Make sure that, you know, using your diaphragm, delineate the junction between the femur and the femoral component all around, so that you know where exactly you should go. Repeat the step with the small saw. You can use a giggly saw, which is a very nice instrument, but remember that giggly saw can cut the distal femur as well, unless you are very, very careful. Your force should always be more towards anteriorly, towards the component, rather than towards the bone. Because the bone is curved, the component is curved, you can make a mistake of cutting the distal femur rather than the junction. Once that has been done, you can see the nice delineation between the component and the femur, and then use the similar technique. Don't try to remove it from the anterior side of the component. Try to remove it posteriorly, because the anterior, you have released it nicely and you are pulling it from the posterior. The chances of you removing the component in an angle is less, so that you don't have a problem with the bone destruction. Clean the cement, then attention towards the patella. Use a nice diatomy to delineate between the patellar component and the bone. Use a broad saw to cut off the patellar button. Then you will be left with these patellar pegs, which will be buried inside the bone. Use your 4.5 mm or 3.2, 3.5 drill bit to drill out that peg pieces of the plastic. Then use a big, nice Chandler's curette. Curette everything out, all the cement metal in the both keels and also in the entry hole of the femoral side. Wash the way you want with hydrogen peroxide, raffine, or whatever the way you want, and make it nice, good, clean, something like this. After that, use something which is very sterile, something like this. Everybody changes their gown, and ideally, if you want, the whole thing is draped again, you can see. And we cut open only the incision area again in the drape, and use either the mold, handmade, ready-made, or antibiotic mixed, like what we has been recommended in the literature. And that is the exposure, and
almost nicely covered the topic, taking you how we have to select the appropriate implant in appropriate situation. The selection of implant is dictated by two. One is the soft tissues, and second is the bone stock available there. So we know this classification in the revisions, zones, the three zones we know, and a lot of metallurgy or what are the components must be available in your OT cupboards. I'm not going to talk much about individual components requests. Next talk we are going to have from my friend Gretchen about the sleeves and all. No doubt, tibial stems plays major role while you are choosing the appropriate implant. They support the implants, fixation stability is greater, and particularly distribute the shear tears, and reduction in bone cement stress, the interface stress is drastically. Bone defects, both either on the femoral or tibial side. Even though we are in the revision session, if you see such X-ray, you must think which implant you are going to use. This is the severe knee, where severe valgus bilateral, you must be prepared for all the either constraint or hinge option. You must keep ready in your theater, and if you are lucky, you do the good soft tissue releases and you balance, you can get away with the constrained implant like DC3. And definitely the hinge have options. Just now we heard the indications when case presentations going on. I don't want to repeat. This is the case. Bilateral TKR was done and patient came with the right side infected knee. You can see the loosened implants and all. So the removed and antibiotic block was applied, and there was a, if you see this one, particularly this X-ray, there is a zone 2 bone loss on the femoral side. So the integrity of the knee, lateral, collateral, medial, collateral is gone. So there is no other option. You had to plan for the hinge option in that particular situation with tibial tubercle osteotomy. The other case, you see here, the knee is infected and almost all the, both the components on the femoral side and tibial side, both the components are loose. And see particularly this case, the bone stock. The femoral side, it is F3 is involved, and you must think of the appropriate implant in that situation. The selection is important. You must keep the limb preservation system ready in your armamentarium. And same the tibial tubercle osteotomy, and that was corrected. This is another case, a 110 kilos lady had a road traffic accident, and there is a global instability. Went to a surgeon, and that is the thing done, stacked all the available skin and pins. And after 2 months, they were removed, and that is the situation came to us. And then once you do the CT and all, yes, there is a bone. There is no bone. The stock is good, but all this is a global instability, and there is no other option. I had to go for the injured knee in that situations. This is, we had morning, I will say, where the neuromuscular involvement is the polio case. And you see the soft tissue, entire lateral envelope is lax, and there is no other way to use the injured knee. And please, you may ask me why you didn't put the stems. You see the lateral, there is no place to put the stems in the polio hypoplastic bones, and luckily the patient is doing well. This is almost all 4 years follow-up X-ray which you have seen. The other one, revision done on the side, right side. And you know, this is one of the first or second generation knees, fixed hinges without rotating platform. So these situations you had to plan properly, and appropriate selection is important, and the LVS is the ideal implant. You had to think about that. So in nutshell, choice of implant design, as we told, it depends upon the bony and the soft tissue. It's a table. The hinge, rigid hinge, is absolutely indicated when all are gone, including the quadriceps compromise. A rotating platform, you can choose when all are compromised except the quadriceps is good. You can go for rotating constraint. Yes, constraint is good for quadriceps good, and either MCL and LCL is good. If MCL is lost, still you can use the constraint implant with medial collateral ligament reconstruction with your semi-T, or you can reinforce. And PS and deep dish and PCL, all of you know where they are very much indicated. Thank you very much.